Our next speaker is Piyush Sharda. He will be talking about...
Takes a second to load.
Yes, the physics of gas-phase metallicities in galaxies.
Thank you. Can you hear me in the back all right? Thanks. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Piyush. I'm an Oort Fellow at Leiden Observatory, and today I'll talk to you about some of the work that we have been doing in terms of better understanding the physics of gas phase metallicities and metal distributions in galaxies. And this work has been done in collaboration with quite a number of people listed on the slide here. So let's see if I can... Right, so... metallicities, we have been studying them for a long time as a part of our galaxy evolution picture. We initially started looking at global metallicities, so getting one value of metallicity from integrated spectra of galaxies back in the SDSS days. And now we very well know that galaxies follow a mass metallicity relation where low mass galaxies are metal poor as compared to more massive galaxies. We see this across redshifts, across galaxies. We see this in the gas phase, but also in the stars. And this has been very well studied, in particular at redshift zero. There's been a lot of research already done to interpret the physical drivers of the mass-metallicity relation and what it means for galaxy evolution. And now we're also starting to explore this at higher redshifts, particularly with JWST. We have been seeing the MZRs go all the way up to redshift 8 or 9. But thanks to IFS or IFU spectroscopy, instead of getting one particular integrated spectra from a galaxy, we can now place different apertures on different parts of the galaxies and get spectra for each of these parts. So we can try to build our picture of galaxy assembly in a spatial resolved way using metallicities. Raymond already touched this a bit in his talk this morning, but just to sort of summarize, to first order, we see that galaxies, at least in the nearby universe, show this inside-out metallicity gradient, where if we measure metallicities in individual H2 regions in galaxies, we see that the galaxies are more metal enriched in the centers as compared to the outskirts, and they usually follow a metallicity gradient that can be steep or flat or even possibly in some cases inverted. Now, we have also been starting to see some of these metallicity gradients at higher redshifts. There are some caveats, though, in terms of, for example, our spatial resolution as well as diffuse ionized gas contamination. That becomes more severe at these redshifts. But now we are starting to get a census of metallicity gradients across redshifts. This is one such result from JWST, where they are looking at a very dwarf lensed galaxy at redshift 3, which shows an inside-out gradient in the particular emission lines that they have used to measure this particular gradient. Now, modeling metallicities is not a new thing, of course. We have been doing this for many years. We started originally by looking at these so-called open and closed box models, where we are only looking at processes internal to the galaxies. So balancing the amount of mass and metals a galaxy has, that should describe the metallicity content of galaxies in general. In the early 2000s to 2010s, we moved to so-called bathtub models of chemical evolution, where the basic idea is that we have included inflows and outflows inside and out of the galaxy. And a lot of work has been done, including by people in this room here, to understand what these bathtub models can tell us about metallicity evolution. And they have been very successful, even though they are very simple, they have been very successful at explaining correlations of various galaxy properties with integrated metallicities. But if we want to understand the physics of spatially resolved metallicity distribution or gradients, we need to go a step beyond. And the reason for this is bathtub models are only looking at the content of metals, so we also need to include processes that do not necessarily change the overall metal content, but they might redistribute metals in the ISM, for example. So we need a better prescription and understanding of our ISM physics, in addition to things that can produce metals or take metals out of the galaxy. So I'll focus a little bit more on a new first principles model that we have come up with, specifically looking at the physics of metallicity gradients, where the picture pretty much remains the same as traditional chemical evolution models that we have been working on in the past for so many years. But it has three main components that are different. First, we are not only solving for the balance between mass and metals, but we also include a balance between energy. And the reason for this is, imagine any system, any ISM, where metals have been produced, they will not be sitting there their entire lifetimes. They'll keep on moving. They'll be redistributed in the galaxy. And that redistribution is very sensitive to the energy equilibrium in these galaxies. So including energy balance, for example, energy due to accretion, star formation feedback, supernova feedback, radial gas flows, turbulence, gives us a new sort of constraint on these models, and also tells us a bit more about not only the overall metal content, but also the metallicity distributions. Once you include energy balance as well, what you can do is you can also look at major modes of metal transport. So what I mean by that is things like advection, so moving metals with the bulk flow of the gas, or diffusion due to turbulence. So metal diffusion also becomes very important in some parts of parameter space and galaxy evolution, and we can include that with an energy balance prescription in these models. And lastly, differential enrichment of outflows is something that is relatively novel component of chemical evolution models, although this has been known for a long time as well. And the basic idea behind this is the metallicity of galactic winds may or may not be the same as that of the ISM of the galaxy. So there could very well be scenarios where as soon as metals are produced, they are ejected in the form of a wind. So the winds are more metal enriched as compared to the ISM of galaxies. And we'll see later on in the talk that this is an important parameter that the models find. Some galaxies should definitely have more metal-enriched winds as compared to others, and it makes a big difference to the overall results. So the first thing that I wanted to quickly touch upon is the so-called mass-metallicity gradient relation. So this is just the resolved form of the MZR. And it has been produced very recently from a few different IFU surveys, so SAMI, Khalifa, Manga, and we are still trying to figure out the origin of this MZGR. So I'll show you the results from the model first. And this is where the parameter space of the model lies. So the x-axis is just the stellar mass. This is all at redshift zero. The y-axis is the metallicity gradients. And this is where the parameters models predict metallicity gradients should lie as a function of galaxy mass. The color bar is a ratio of two processes that try and redistribute metals or dilute the metallicity overall. So accretion of gas or radial gas flows, for example. And there's no particular reason to choose these two ratios. There's other processes in the model as well. This is just an example to show what happens when you look at these processes in particular. At fixed stellar mass, all of the models have a vertical scatter, and that scatter comes from this differential enrichment of outflows. So basically, this is a free parameter in the model because we don't really have constraints over outflow metallicities from observations. If galaxies, real galaxies, prefer to lie in the bottom part of these color bars, that simply means the metallicity of the wind is the same as the ISM metallicity. And that is the normal assumption we have always been making in our chemical evolution models. However, if galaxies prefer to lie closer to the upper edge here, that means the wind metallicities are very, very high as compared to their ISM metallicities. So the winds are effectively taking out a lot of metals from these galaxies. And if I overplot results from these three surveys, this is where the data lie. The three different markers correspond to the three different IFU surveys, and the gray markers correspond to a mean of these. Each point here has a few hundred galaxies where they have been reanalyzed in the same way. They have been the effects of spatial resolution have been taken into account. The diffuse ionized gas still remains a contaminant, but this gives us a very nice statistical a population of galaxies to play with and understand the physics of metallicity gradients. And one of the most striking things we can immediately see is that at low masses, galaxies are preferring a parameter space of the model where winds are metal enriched. This is not new. This was already seen in the MZR as well around 10 years ago, where people were finding that even to explain the MZR, we need at low masses winds that are more metal enriched. So it's just nice to see that even the resolved relations with metallicities and galaxy masses prefer the same conclusion in terms of the metallicity of winds. However, measurements of wind metallicities remain really, really scarce. So to date, there's only very, very few galaxies where we have been able to measure a wind metal loading factor, not just the mass loading factor. And even in these galaxies, these numbers are upper limits here. And the reason for that is we are only looking at winds in one particular phase. We're not looking at the multi-phase component of galactic winds. The predictions from the model say that metal mass loading seems to be a lot more important than mass loading in general for spatially resolved metal distributions. So on this plot, you can see the mass loading factors as a function of stellar mass from different simulations, FIRE, EAGLE, also some analytical models. And you see that they produce very different mass loading factors across this range in stellar mass. However, this still produces very similar metallicity gradients. It's more the metal mass loading or the wind metallicity that makes a bigger difference. Now, I've been talking about energy balance, and one of the cool new things we can do with these sort of models is look at the correlation between kinematics of the gas, so turbulence in particular, and the relation to spatially resolved metallicities. And this has not really been done before using chemical evolution models because we did not have energy balance until now. We can do this more easily at, well, low redshifts now, so all the way from redshift 0 to 3, because we do see galaxies show a very wide diversity of their gas kinematics. So here is the gas dispersion plot from Emily's papers. And they also have a lot of scatter in the gas phase metallicity gradients at these redshifts. So I'll go back and show results from the model first, where the y-axis here, again, is the metallicity gradient. The x-axis is the gas velocity dispersion in galaxies. And the three different model curves correspond to three different values of the rotational velocity. So this is a proxy for the stellar mass of the galaxy. These curves are for a particular case of the wind metallicity. It's like a limiting bound. So these are the steepest metallicity gradients the model can produce for a given stellar mass, for a given velocity dispersion. And we would like to see where does the data lie. Does the data satisfy the bounds that the model is producing or not? And again, there's not a lot of data to play around with, although JWST will hopefully change this really soon. We only have around 70-ish galaxies where we can self-consistently derive the gas kinematics. So these are coming from Symphony AO observations or KMOS 3D, where we can also derive the metallicity gradients, again, in a consistent manner. You can still see the error bars are still quite high. Nonetheless, there is a predictive power in this sort of a comparison, and it's more so for the future that we do see galaxies on average tend to satisfy these bounds given by the models at very, very high velocity dispersions. Over here, we are getting very flat gradients in the model, and intuitively we can understand this as more turbulence that leads to more metal mixing, gives you flat metal distributions. However, the more interesting part is at the low velocity dispersion ends. And of course, the caveat is that we are not really, these velocity dispersions are below the instrumental resolution. So we are trying to do, take beam splitting into account, but I'm not sure if we can really trust these values yet. Anyway, from models, it seems that at low velocity dispersions, the relative strength of accretion becomes more important because the turbulence is really low. And that leads to more efficient dilution of metallicity throughout the galaxy. And that, again, gives you very flat gradients. We can also do this in simulations. So TNG, in particular, has done this as well. And if you were to overplot plots their TNG galaxies on this plot, they also seem to satisfy these bounds pretty well. So this is a very nice way to understand like how kinematics redistribute metals. And then we can now distill them into analytical models like these to better understand how metallicity gradients are coming into place. Another thing we could do, for example, is just look at the scatter function for the data in the models. So again, the x-axis is the same. The y-axis here is the scatter in the data and the scatter in the models. What matters more here is not the absolute magnitude of the scatter function, but the shape. And the fact that the model shapes sort of closely align with what the data tells us right now means that, again, metal-enriched winds are doing something important even at these redshifts, which is sort of expected given that these galaxies are forming stars quite rigorously. This is, of course, just the beginning, because we have amazing spectra like these now from JLVST at higher and higher redshifts. And we would really like to understand, once we can reliably get some metallicity estimates from these emission lines, what is this telling us about the metal distribution at these higher redshifts, and how can we use that to put further constraints on our models of galaxy evolution. Before I finish, I quickly wanted to say that this is not only extragalactic. We can also turn this back to our own galaxy and look at, for example, the time evolution of the metallicity gradient within our own galaxy and compare this with the data we have as well as with simulations. But because we can actually measure metallicities in individual stars, and now we have big, large spectroscopic surveys like Apogee or Gala or LAMOST, we can do much better than that. We can combine these ISM chemical evolution models with radial migration models to constrain full 2D or actually 3D metallicity distribution functions of Milky Way stars, which are very carefully selected for selection effects, but also for making sure we are selecting a homogeneous population which belongs to the thin disk and so on, where these sort of models are applicable. And this is a very promising area of further research, because we can now start to connect chemical evolution in the Milky Way on a very detailed level with chemical evolution that we see in galaxies, in extragalactic observations. So I'll just finish here. We have introduced a new model to explain trends in spatial resolved metallicities. There are some particular tests or applications of the model that are included in a bunch of papers. I presented a couple of them now. But this will become really more interesting at higher redshifts with JLVST in the future, but also for our own Milky Way with spectroscopic data like Apogee, LAMOST, and Gala as well. So thank you for your attention, and happy to take any questions.
Just a very quick query. If you take this top plot,
yeah.
So have you seen any trend if you plot, instead of stellar mass, if you plot these galaxies as a function of star formation rate density? I would guess that would actually have a much better correlation.
Yeah, so I haven't done that yet, but that is, like, we have a student in the group working on exactly that, so looking at correlations with star formation rate, and the idea is to more closely look at
rate density.
The star formation rate, the surface density, yes.
Yeah, okay.
And the idea is to look at the fundamental metallicity relation
and
the resolved counterparts of the FMR in that respect.
Fantastic.
Yeah, but there will definitely be a correlation there. Yes.
Fantastic. Thank you.
The next speaker can set up, but meanwhile, we can take another quick question, maybe.
Could I ask whether bars can help to make a transport of the metallicity in a way that is different from what you've been showing?
Yeah, definitely. We don't include bars in these models, of course, but they will definitely help redistribute metals, especially in the innermost regions.
Yes.
But the assumption here is that we are still looking at equilibrium models.
Okay.
And with bars, I think that sort of starts to break down in particular, especially in the innermost regions. We're also only looking at parts where the rotation curve is changing, is either flat or is changing linearly. But if you're very close to the galactic center where you have bars, then rotation curve changes a bit non-linearly, and then we cannot include them.
Okay. Next phase.
We send Pirish again.